Northwestern Medicine researchers discover a cause of baldness in mice. Scientists probe the atmosphere of a distant exoplanet. A study of the pelvis of a saber-toothed tiger reveals the caring side of an extinct big cat, and how mass poaching has led to tuskless elephants in Mozambique. Joining us now to help explain the science behind the headlines is University of Chicago paleontologist Neil Shubin. Neil, welcome back. I think the last time you and I spoke was some time ago when the pandemic first began, and so there's been a lot of science news to cover. But let's start with scientists at Northwestern Medicine. They have discovered a cause of balding in mice that could have implications for treatments of hair loss in men and women. What did these researchers do, and what did they discover?
Well, they discovered mice that actually go bald, both the males and the females. They lose their hair by 6 months. And what happens in these mice is the hair, just like humans, grows out of hair follicles. And inside the hair follicles are stem cells, special cells, that are important for the rejuvenation of the follicle. Turns out in these mice, the stem cells are detached from the follicle, just abnormally, and then they leave the follicle, and then the follicle degenerates. So these stem cells are really necessary for it, and they identified a series of genes, mutations, that cause this kind of baldness. And since humans have these genes and humans have these stem cells, perhaps there's an analogy and some important consequences for human baldness.
Well, and on that note, you know, are there similarities between mice and humans for this to potentially lead to treatments for humans?
Yeah, there are. The genes of mice and people, particularly in this case, that are controlling the stem cells, are similar enough that what researchers are interested in doing is maybe trying to keep these genes functioning. That is, to keep these genes making the kinds of glue that hold the stem cells there. If they can do it in mice, then maybe they can do it in people, and it'll be one way to avoid and prevent baldness in humans.
Okay, so an international team of scientists, including researchers from the University of Chicago, they've discovered a new way to probe the atmosphere of a distant planet some 340 light years away. How did they do this, and what did they find?
Think about that. This is amazing. What they did is they used a ground-based telescope in Chile, on top of a mountain in Chile. And what they did is they designed a technique to analyze the light from this particular planet, which they is 340 light years away. It's just enormous distance. And what they did is they were able to pick up the wavelengths of the light and interpret what molecules are in the atmosphere. And not only that, but their abundances. So they were able to tell that there is a certain concentration of water and a certain concentration of carbon monoxide in this planet, which is so far away. It's just a stunning technology.
Now, we're calling this next story, Hips Don't Lie. Researchers studying the bones of a saber-toothed tiger cats at La Brea Tar Pits in L.A., they say they've discovered a softer side of these ferocious-looking cats. How did they make this discovery?
Yeah, there are thousands and thousands and thousands of bones known from the La Brea Tar Pits, and some of them are saber-toothed tigers. Well, it turns out some of these tigers have great gross deformities in their hip joints, in both the pelvis and the femur. And so scientists collaborated with the orthopedic surgeons from UCLA, paleontologists working with doctors, with physicians and surgeons, were able to identify that these hips were not deformed because of accidents or disease. These saber-toothed tigers were born with these kinds of hips. There's no way they could have walked normally. Now think about that for a second. In the wild, animals born with deformed hips, particularly saber-toothed tigers, which are known to hunt aggressively and take in a very aggressive style, there's no way these animals would have survived without help. So what does it show? It shows social structures in these extinct creatures, which we never would have imagined.
Right. They were born with a hip dysplasia, meaning they, like, in order to even have food, family members would have had to have helped them, basically share food with them and protect them.
That's right. It's amazing, isn't it, that what you can interpret from these fossils. And so they clearly had help. And, you know, they clearly were supported throughout their entire lives with enduring hunting or relatives providing them food. We don't know the type of social interaction. We just know they survived because of those social interactions.
Okay. Researchers in Mozambique, though, they say that widespread poaching has literally changed the evolution of elephants. What have they found there?
Isn't that amazing? So elephants have really suffered from poaching, particularly during the Civil War, which ran in Mozambique from about 1972 to 1997. During that time, poachers were killing elephants for their ivory, which is obviously worth a considerable amount of money, and wiped out about 90% of the population in Mozambique. What that did is it was actually a selection experiment. They actually cause natural selection in the wild, such that typically in elephant populations, there's a low level of a mutation that causes individuals not to have tusks. What happened in this case is it favored the evolution of creatures that didn't have tusks because they survived poaching. The poachers wouldn't kill them. So what we've seen is that the frequency of this mutation, tuskless elephants, has increased over time. And the idea is that it increased largely because poachers were wiping out the animals that had tusks.
And before we let you go, Neil, you know, in the absence of poaching, would this, the impact of this mutation, could it be reversed?
Yeah, that's the thinking. That is, you know, with the increased regulations on poaching, which is increased enforcement on poaching, the idea is within the next 10 to 15 years, we find tusks return.
Okay. Neil Shubin, good to see you again. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.